Hey everybody, it's John. Welcome to One Side of a Two-Car Garage. This is going to be a two-part video. I've received questions over the past few months concerning how satisfied am I still of the Grizzly Mill, and how satisfied or would I recommend the DRO or digital readout that I added as secondary. So I'm going to split this into two parts. First talk about the Mill, and then we'll talk about the DRO. As a spoiler alert, I'm very satisfied with both of them. I'll go into a little bit of detail about some of the things that I like, which is most all the things, and some of the things that you might want to consider if you're looking for one of these small benchtop mills. The video that I'm working with today concerns specifically the Grizzly G704, but there's other similar benchtop machines out there. You could probably go up a couple of sizes or down a couple of sizes, and a lot of these comments will fit both of them. And the second video is going to be the DRO. Talk a little bit about the installation of the DRO and the pros and cons and where I got it, how I installed it, and so forth. And this is a four-year review after using this. So come on and join me over here at the milling machine, and we'll go through this thing top to bottom. I've had this mill, it's the G704. I've had it since 2016. So just real quickly, I'll review the mill. As I said before, it's a 2016. This is considered a benchtop mill, and every shop is going to be different. Yours will be different from mine. So I probably should preface a little bit about what I focus on. Everything that I focus on is model engineering. I don't do any commercial work. I don't do any large work. Most everything I do, in fact, virtually everything I do, fits in the 4-inch mill vise itself. So while I could get by with a mini mill, I do enjoy the extra power, the extra height of the between the drill chuck and the table itself. So I'll bring you in a little closer, talk about some of the things about the G704 mill, then go into the DRO. I'll talk a little bit about the top of the mill here. This is not a direct drive mill, but the motor is at the top. It's a 110 volt or 120 volt mill. I don't know the horsepower of it. You can check in the specs. I probably should have done that before. But anyway, the horsepower I would say is adequate. I've never bogged the mill down or anything, but the biggest collet that I use, the biggest C5 collet that I use, a 5C collet that I use, is half inch. And so the biggest mill that I use, and again, for my work, will be a half inch. Most of the time, I'm using somewhere in the neighborhood of a 3/8 to 1/4 all the way down to a 1/16 inch end mill. And this works just fine for that. A couple of things that if I had either the finances to or had a magic wand that I would do is I would go with a belt drive up here. There is a weak link in here. Now, the weak link that I'm talking about is a weak link that other people have mentioned. I've not had any problem with the plastic gears that are in it. And again, remember, I'm model engineering, not doing heavy work. And now I do work with steel, and I work with stainless steel and aluminum, and probably about a pretty even mix with all those, with a little brass thrown in occasionally. But it does have a plastic intermediate gear in here that's supposed to be a safety protection. There is some indication that if you stress the mill too much, you will replace that gear. And offhand, I'm going to say that that gear replacement is somewhere in the neighborhood of $40. There are some 3D printable gears that are online that you could use ABS or nylon, but there's some question about whether those hold up or not. If I had a rather, I would do without the intermediate gear, and I would go with a belt drive. If I ever were to make one modification on the mill, I don't know if the belt drive would be first, but it would be one of a list of 3 or 4 modifications that I would do on the mill. So that's the head. It does have, right in here, is a Z-axis DRO. I'll talk more about the DRO that I added on in just a few moments. But the DRO that they have here, it does work. It works well. And the battery life, I don't understand how these batteries work so long, but many times I forget to turn this thing off, sometimes for up to a week, and come out, and I bet I don't change this battery over 3 or 4 months. And it's just one of those little coin batteries. You can pick them up at Dollar Tree, or you can spend a little bit more and order them off Amazon, a little bit better quality. But the battery life on the DRO for the Z-axis is pretty good. However, the Z-axis for me is difficult to read. I'm over 6 feet tall. I'm about 6'4". And the DRO, because it's not backlit, you have to get down and really look at it. I have found the DRO to be as accurate for my needs as I need to be. Now, the DRO only works for the quill. It does not work for the Z axis back here in the back as you raise and lower the head. It is variable speed. It's, if I had to dial 1,256 RPM, I probably wouldn't do that. And you probably wouldn't ever need to do that. So it gets pretty close. And, if you need to run 1,200, it's probably not going to make a big difference. If you hit 1,150 or 1,250, you just do that. I actually never look at the RPM. You can just listen to the machine, and you'll know if you need to add more or take a little less speed off of it, depending on the material you're cutting, the depth of cut, and so forth like that. It does have a reverse. About the only time that I've ever used reverse is if I sometimes have used a fly cutter, that I've had an insert, a tool that, wasn't turned the right way, so I just went ahead and reversed the mill. But I don't ever use reverse. I can't think of any time that I've ever used it. May have, but I can't recall offhand. The raising up and down, I really wish it had a gas assist on it. It does not. Actually, I really wish it had a motorized Z-axis. You can get that. Grizzly sells that. I think I noticed that in the catalog. And I saw it as an accessory, and that's probably something to consider. One of the things I might do is put a gas shock on each side of it. I've seen that. I find myself, this is the lever that I actually use as much as the Z axis or the Y axis, because every time you're doing something, I'm having to look around and raise this head. It's not difficult to do, but it sure makes your right arm a little stronger after a day in the shop. As far as clearance goes, I'll talk about the clearance between the drill chuck and the milling machine, and we'll talk about that now. What I've got right here is just plywood. I keep this on as a bed protector. And the milling table, and I don't know the dimensions of it, you can look those up online, but since I do mostly model work, this is more than adequate for me. The vise that I have here is a 4-inch vise. I got the vise off Amazon. And by the way, there's a link down below for all this stuff that I'm showing you here. But this vise came off Amazon. It did have a swivel base on it. I did take the swivel base off. I'm not a big proponent of swivel vises. There's other ways that I can do it if I need to do a swivel. And also it gives you about another inch or two of head space. But what you're seeing right now is, and I'll get you the inches of clearance that I have right now. What I have in here right now is a 3/8 end mill, which is probably 95% of all the work that I do is with a 3/8 end mill. It's in a collet, 5C collet, and then I've got that 4-inch vise. And so I've got a working room right now of about 7 inches between the end of the mill and the top of my workplace. The only time that I've really ran out of room is when I've got the drill chuck in, because the drill chuck is actually going to take about another inch and a half. And if I'm using a tap follower, one of these things that you know, when you're tapping, you put it in here to keep pressure on your tap. By the time you get that in there and your drill chuck in, and you got your tap wrench in there, if you're using something tall, that's really the only time that I've ever run out of room on that. So what I do is I just keep a little 60 degree plug over here that I turned in the lathe. I put that in the drill chuck. And again, this is a collet, not a chuck, but I just put that in the drill chuck where all I have laying out is the end of this little point. And when I put that in there, my tap wrench and everything fits in there fine. So it's inconvenient, but it's not something that you cannot work around if you had to. Again, the vise is pretty much stays on here all the time. Once I get it dialed in, it's not hard to dial in, of course, but it's just one of those things that I don't normally do. I leave it on here and all my work is done in the vise. The X and Y axis, this works really smooth. I do get some kind of a chatter every once in a while when I'm using the Y axis. And I guess what I need to do is actually take this table off and go in and try to investigate that. I don't get any chatter in my finish. It's just every once in a while when I pull this out, I get a little shake down here. And I'm really surprised I'm not getting that in my finish. But so far, so good. The table locks that are on it are adequate, and that's about all I can say. This one right here, I actually have replaced that with a Allen screw, metric Allen screw, and I've done stuff with the other ones. It's the kind that's got, I don't put the camera down here to show you, but it's kind of, that's got the little lever on it that flips down. They're not much good. They do hold the table, but they're just, I wish it had something else besides that on there, but I don't know what to do about it. It does have the table locks or the stops on it. I do use those all the time or fairly regularly, and I just keep the Allen wrench up here that goes in it, and then they move along the axis there for putting stuff in place. The stand that came with it is, it's okay. It's not tall enough for me. As I said before, I'm pretty tall, and I like to have everything, my work that I try to get, I try to get most of the work right along this elbow line right here. This is still a little bit low, and I've got it on a 3-inch channel iron down here at the bottom to raise it up an extra 3 inches. It's pretty solid. If one thing I would change, and I'm not real sure I'm going to leave this here permanently. I'm hopefully, before too long, I can get a little shop built out in the backyard. I think if I'm going to change it, I'm going to mount this. There's some video online that shows some mods where you actually use all thread and mount this to the rod to mount the stand to the wall, just with some all thread stretchers tapped into a 2x4 back there. I think that would really help. Overall, I mean, this thing is pretty steady. It really, you know, if I shake it hard, I can shake it, but on the work that I do, it doesn't do it. The stand does have a door in it. It's got one shelf in it, and it's just made out of sheet metal. Nothing special. You'd probably be just as well off if you didn't have the stand with it, but I think it does come with the stand included in it. Like I say, I've had it now for 4 years. It has worked flawlessly. I did take the guard off of it. It had a little safety guard on it that, you know, you could cut it on and off by opening that up. I took that off. It was, I just like to see what I'm looking at, and I wear safety glasses. It does have a tendency to throw shavings everywhere, but it seems to work pretty good. Overall, if I were going to buy this mill again, I would definitely buy it again. I would also look at Precision Matthews. Now, their mill does have some advantages on it. It's got a little different gearing up at the top, and it does have scraped ways down here where I think these may be machined or ground. I can't remember. But overall, I can hold as good an accuracy as I am. The accuracy is not dependent on the milling machine. It's dependent on the operator, which is me. If you have any questions on this mill, my email address is in the About Me. If you'd email me, I'll be more than happy to answer the questions. Like I say, I'm not selling these things. It's just, I've been pretty happy with it. I bought several things from Grizzly, and they seem to be pretty good folks. As good, I guess, as anybody else out through there. If you have any specific questions that weren't answered in here, feel free to email me. My email address can be found under the About Me tab. A lot of times, if it's in a video comment, sometimes they end up in a trash bin or spam folder or something. Also, the same thing if you email. If you'll put in the subject line question about mill or question about DRO, a lot of times I'm more apt to see that. So until next time, from one side of a two-car garage on the Upper East Side of Texas, this is John, and we'll see you on the next video.